Hey Roy.
Hi.
Hey. Good to see you.
Thanks for coming.
Hi, my name is Joel Lazarus. I'm an academic and I've also been involved in political campaigning and community education work back in the UK where I'm from. Almost a year ago now I moved to Singapore with my wife and family, and that's when I first came to know of the work and the campaigns of a young blogger called Roy Ngerng. And Roy has very, very kindly invited me into his home today to discuss his story, which is one I believe that obviously everybody in Singapore should know about, but people around the world really should know about. And I really first came to know of you, Roy, when I got here, and soon after I was writing an article for a website called Column F about poverty and inequality in Singapore, about which I knew very little. So I was very grateful to come across a website called The Heart Truths that was just so full of excellently researched statistical and graphic material and data about the situation in Singapore. So the first question is really how you started to research this stuff and write about it and start to campaign about it.
Well, most people know that Singapore is one of the richest countries in the world with one of the highest GDP per capita in the world. People also know that many surveys have actually put Singaporeans as being one of the least happy people in the world and also one of the most emotionless people in the world. So to me, I want to know why that is the case, where we are such a rich country but the people feel so poor inside. And I attribute that to the policies. If you look at the policies, there's no minimum wage, there's no poverty line. Singapore still has one of the lowest wages as compared to the developed countries. Yet we are ranked by The Economist as being the most expensive country in the world. If you look at the purchasing power, we have the lowest purchasing power as compared to the other developed countries. Healthcare spending is the lowest among the developed countries by the government. And to me, this is a concern. If a country is so rich, why are the people languishing at an estimated poverty rate of 30% and one of the highest income inequality among the developed countries and one of the highest income inequality? I wanted to know what was wrong and I wanted to advocate to the government for change. But as I did that, I realized that the problem might actually lie with the government itself, which is resistant towards having a more equal society. This current government, this current political party has been in government for the past 50 years, the People's Action Party. In 1982, they actually changed their manifesto from wanting to achieve equality to self-reliance. And that was when things started to change in Singapore for the past 30 years. And I want to change that.
Yeah, that comes out very, very clearly, obviously, in your work and your campaigns. And you focus on the government and its policies. And of course, one of the policies that has been central to the government's activities and the lives of Singaporeans, and of course, therefore, your own work and research and campaigning, has been that of the CPF, the Central Provident Fund. So tell us, if you could, about the CPF, what it is, what the big issue is regarding it, and what you've discovered.
Well, the CPF is the retirement funds of Singaporeans. So Singaporeans actually have to sacrifice about 37% of our wages every month into the CPF. This is mandatory. And when you compare it with the other social security systems in the world, we also pay the highest social contribution rate. But even though we pay the highest social contribution rate, we actually get one of the least adequate retirement funds in the world. Our retirement funds, the CPF, is actually invested in two of the sovereign wealth funds, GIC and Temasek Holdings, which are investment firms that the government owns. Right now, the two investment firms rank as the top 10 richest sovereign wealth funds in the world. But the money that they take from us, our CPF, is ranked the least adequate, or one of the least adequate in the world. To me, that is a discrepancy. The government actually takes our CPF to earn 6% in GIC, but we only earn an average of 3% in the CPF. This means that each Singaporean might be losing as much as a few hundred thousand dollars or even more than $1 million per person. I think that's a discrepancy. And when you look at the GIC, the board of directors is also made up of the government. So then I question, where is the government's allegiance? Is it towards taking care and protecting the lives of Singaporeans, or is it towards making money in the GIC? And when you see that the GIC has earned an estimated $400 billion using our CPF, and we have one of the least adequate CPF in the world, I think that's a huge problem.
Well, that clearly is a big issue, and it's a perfectly legitimate political question to ask. And it's a question that every Singaporean citizen clearly should be concerned with. And it was in one of the blogs concerning that discrepancy between the returns that GIC and Temasek earn and what the CPF pays out to Singaporeans that got you in quite some hot water when Singaporean Prime Minister, Lee Hsien Loong, took offence to one of the articles and subsequently sued you for defamation of character. The judge finally gave the verdicts in favour of the Prime Minister. You were found guilty of defaming him and were charged with paying him considerable damages. So could you tell me what you can for legal reasons about that event?
Well, most Singaporeans would know by now that I've been sued for defamation. I cannot say too much about that. But a few weeks after I got sued, I actually lost my job. I was fired by the hospital that I was employed in. They sent out a press release. I had to pack my bags and go within an hour. Then the Ministry of Health also sent out a press release to support the firing. We held a few protests after that. We wanted to advocate for transparency and accountability on our CPF and for the government to reform the system to ensure that Singaporeans are able to retire. However, after the fourth protest was held, I was also levied with a police charge for demonstrating illegally without a permit, as well as public nuisance.
Yes, but you have been helped in your defence fund, and I think that is an encouraging story to tell.
After I got sued, I actually raised funds for it to help to pay for the legal fees. We wanted to raise $70,000, and we managed to get $110,000 from about 4,000 Singaporeans. And I think the reason why is because Singaporeans are really unhappy that their CPF is stuck inside and they are not able to actually retrieve it to use for retirement, while the money is actually taken away by the government for their own investments.
Yeah. Are you the first ordinary Singaporean to be sued in this way?
Well, yes, I am actually the first ordinary Singaporean to be sued for defamation. In the past, the government has used the defamation law against opposition members to bankrupt them, to prevent them from running for elections. And there was an opposition member who was sued for $8 million. But before that, the government has actually used the Internal Security Act, which allows them to imprison Singaporeans without trial. In the 1960s, in 1963 to be exact, the government arrested more than 100 Singaporeans, opposition members, labour unionists, student unionists, put them into jail without trial. Some of them were kept in and jailed for more than 20-30 years. The government wanted to do that to create a sense of fear, and because of that, it has caused Singaporeans to retain that level of fear. And this ISA, the Internal Security Act, was used in the 1960s, 70s, as well as the 1980s, before the government stopped using it, because in 1987, they arrested more than 20 Singaporeans, social workers, lawyers, and imprisoned some of them for more than 2 years. There was a global outcry, and the government stopped using that. But the government went on to use the defamation law and has been doing that for the past 20 years. And over the past 2 years, they have even used the Sedition Act, contempt of court against ordinary Singaporeans, and now the defamation law has been used for the first time on an ordinary Singaporean to silence the dissent.
So what you describe is a climate of fear, and I wonder if that climate of fear helps us really understand a situation where in Hong Kong you've got so many people coming out on the streets bravely to fight for their rights and better futures for themselves and their families, whereas in Singapore so little is going on.
Well, I think the situation in Hong Kong and Singapore is actually very similar. The economic background is very similar. Both countries are the most unequal countries among the developed countries and one of the most unequal in the world. We also have the same highest prices, highest property prices, lowest wages, and high poverty levels. But the people in Hong Kong know that for their survival and for their future, they have to stand the fight. If you look at interviews that were done with the people in Hong Kong, they would say that for my life, for my home, for my family, I would fight. But if you look at Singapore, the people would say that for my home, for my family, I wouldn't fight. And that's because of the fear that is so pervasive among Singaporeans.
So what would you say? What would you want the message that you want to really send out to Singaporeans in that sense?
I think one thing that Singaporeans have to know is that for our future, we have to fight for it. I mean, if you look at Hong Kong, they know that they stand slim chances, but they would fight. But in Singapore, we have every opportunity to be able to turn things around for ourselves. And when we do that, when the government changes, there's still the civil service, civil society, think tanks, academics, civil society who are all ready to step up. They have been coming up with solutions for the past 30 years, and everyone's waiting to see change come by enacting these solutions which will protect Singaporeans. So I hope that Singaporeans are able to look beyond this fear that compromises on our logic and compromises on our willingness to see change come to Singapore. Now, and if you look at the Singapore model, many countries believe that they can follow this model to achieve economic growth. But this model is based on depressing wages and taking the money that workers could have earned into profits. And this has created a rich-poor gap. Singapore now has the widest rich-poor gap among the developed countries. And if you look at history, and many research and studies have shown this, societies which have become too unequal, all these societies have collapsed, and the society have fractured. So I think that people need to know that if they follow the Singapore model, it can be dangerous for their society and for the social compact that they want to keep. If we want a future and a sustainable future for Singapore as well as for the world, we need to change the system and go towards one which promotes equality and protects the people.
Well, I couldn't agree more, and it really just remains for me to thank you very much for your time and to wish you every success for the future, not just for yourself, but also for Singapore. Thank you very much.
Thank you.